Everyone who has two eyes and two ears connected to his head can hear, can see, can understand that there is a struggle over Jerusalem. We see it on in the streets of Jerusalem, demonstrations in good case and Molotov cocktails in the bad case. We see it in academic institutions where the connection between the Jewish people and Jerusalem is being challenged. We see it in UN organizations like UNESCO, the organization which is in charge of preserving world history and culture, forgets that Jerusalem has any connection with Judaism, only with Islam and Christianity. We see politicians who refrain to move the embassies to Jerusalem because they are afraid to aggravate all kinds of people. And until this very day, Jerusalem is not recognized by most countries in the world as the Jewish capital, although Jerusalem as a capital is the oldest capital in the whole world. When was Ottawa? When became Ottawa? Or Washington, D.C.? Even Paris and London and Brussels, all of them became capitals in the Middle Ages, while Jerusalem turned into our capital when King David moved his headquarters from Hebron to Jerusalem more than 1,000 years before the Common Era. So this is, unfortunately, in spite of history which nobody denies, especially in the Western civilization, Jerusalem is not yet being recognized as Israel's capital, mainly because of the Arab and Islamic pressure. Means that the struggle over Jerusalem also arrives into the political echelons of states like Canada and others as well. We can hear it in the press, in the media, in all kinds of media, that there is struggle over Jerusalem. And the question is why? Okay, to us, I don't have to elaborate on the centrality of Jerusalem in the life of Judaism. This is our direction of prayer. It was, they never changed. And wherever you are in the world, you pray towards Jerusalem. Jerusalem is mentioned in our tefillot, mentioned when we in the happy moments of our life, when we marry our children, and unfortunately we also commemorate it when we in the sad moments of our life. Jerusalem is actually, I would say, is something which, a thread which goes through Jewish life since a person was born until he's being buried. So for us Jews, I don't have to elaborate about the centrality of Jerusalem in our communal and personal life. The question is, what do they have, the Muslims, what do they have with Jerusalem? After all, Islam was not established in Jerusalem. The history of Islam starts in Mecca, not in Jerusalem. Mecca, Medina, Jerusalem became only later. Not only this, historically, there was not even one day in history, of the Islamic history, which Jerusalem served as a capital of anything connected to the Arab or the Islamic world. Today, the Palestinians claim that Jerusalem should be the capital of their future state. And without having Jerusalem as the capital, they will not have a state. I mean, they will not declare statehood. Means they actually make a condition. In order to have a Palestinian state, the condition is to have Jerusalem. Since when Jerusalem was a capital? Of any Arab or any Islamic country? Never. Never a caliph or a king or a sultan or emir, any manifestation of government in the Islamic or the Arab world, never took Jerusalem as a capital. So why do the Palestinians claim that without Jerusalem they will not have a state as a capital, of course? So historically, their claim to Jerusalem is totally baseless because of the fact that Jerusalem never served as any capital of anything. Politically, there is another problem here. Let's say Jordan, for example, keeps telling us since 5-6 years every day almost, that Israel should establish a Palestinian state in the West Bank and Gaza, of course, with Jerusalem as its capital. I asked them, whenever I'm in the Jordanian media, I asked them, do you believe that Palestinians should have a Palestinian state with Jerusalem as its capital? So everyone says, yes, of course. So I asked them, why didn't you do it when you controlled, when you occupied the West Bank, as you call it, with East Jerusalem for 19 years, between 1948 and 1967. You had 19 years to establish a Palestinian state on the West Bank with Jerusalem, East Jerusalem, as its capital. Why didn't you do that? Why didn't you do it? You had not 19 years, you had 7,000 days, more or less. So you had 7,000 opportunities to do exactly what you demand us to do, and you didn't do it. What happened? Why should we do something which you didn't do when you could? They never answer. You will know the answer later. The Arab world, which also calls upon Israel to establish a Palestinian state with East Jerusalem, why didn't the same Arab world maintain any pressure on Jordan during those years of 48 to 67 to do exactly the same thing? Why what is correct to do today was not correct, or it was not even in the air on those 19 years between 48 and 67? The European countries who also advocate the establishing of Palestinian state with Jerusalem as the capital, is Jerusalem. What did they do those years with Jordan to do the same thing? Nothing. Means something politically here is fishy, because the whole world today wants to do something which beforehand nobody talked about, nobody thought that it is necessary. Okay, so it also doesn't smell well. So they tell us that Jerusalem is the third place in holiness for Muslims after Mecca and Medina. Mecca is the first, Medina is the second, and Jerusalem is the third place in holiness for Islam. This is a common knowledge, everybody knows it. Yet, if we check this allegation, we find very easily two problems. First of all, yes, Jerusalem is considered a holy place, but only for the Sunni Islam. Shia traditionally never considered Jerusalem to be any holier than any other city. For the Shia, the third place in holiness is the town of Najaf in southern Iraq. They call it Najaf al-Ashraf, means the marvelous Najaf. This is the third place in holiness after Mecca and Medina for the Shia, traditionally. The Shia started to talk about Jerusalem only after the revolution of Khomeini in 1979. And the Shia exists since the year of 632, since the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, died. At that moment, the Shia was born from a debate about the succession of Muhammad. So, along 14 centuries almost, the Shia never heard about Jerusalem. Only in the last 40 years, exactly 40 years, since the revolution of Khomeini, only then they started to speak about Jerusalem. So, it is, I would say, fake news about the Shia in Jerusalem. Modern news. Not only this, even within the Islamic, within the Sunni realm, there are, or there were, two, I would say, prominent philosophers which belong to the Sunni Islam, which did not consider Jerusalem as holier than any other city apart from Mecca and Medina. One of them was named Razali. He was one of the leading figures of the Sufi Islam. He died in the year of 1111. It's very easy to memorize when he died. You know, in Islam, you almost never know when people were born because they never registered the birth. Only when a prominent philosopher died, so everybody knows where he died, when he died. But birth, they know more or less. So he died in 1111. And another philosopher, even more important, is Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah was one of the cornerstones of the Hanbali school of thought in the Sunni Islam, which the Saudis follow today. The Saudis are, the Wahhabi Islam is part of the Hanbali school, which Ibn Taymiyyah was one of the leading figures. Many researchers compare him to Maimonides in our tradition, Ibn Taymiyyah in the Islamic tradition. He did not consider Jerusalem any holier than any other city like Beirut, Damascus, Cairo, or Alexandria. Okay, and he had good reasons. We'll find out. So, not only the Shia, and look, Shia are not three people. Shia are like one of six from the Islamic world. Means some quarter of a billion, 250 million people, more or less, are Shi'i Muslims. And traditionally, they have no connection to Jerusalem, according to their interpretation. So, it's not, to say in Arabic, a kleinigkeit. Okay? It's not a little thing that the Shia do. And of course, here come also the Ibn Taymiyyah and Razali. So, it is some kind of, how did Jerusalem become so holy for Muslims? And this is what we actually were going to deal with in this evening. How did Jerusalem become so holy for Muslims that they fight over Jerusalem with Jews and maybe with Christians as well? Since the question is about the religion, we have to follow what is written, because Islam, like Judaism, is a religion which is based on texts. In Hebrew, in Judaism, it is the Torah, the Nevi'im, Ketuvim, Mishnah, Talmud, Midrashim, and Perushim, which are all written texts. So if you want to check something in Judaism, you go to the texts. The same thing with Islam. Islam has the Quran as parallel to the Bible, and the Hadith parallel to the oral tradition. Okay? The Sharia, which people talk about, is parallel to the Halakha. Okay, so we have another, there is another very important source in Islam, which is called the Sira. Sira means the biography of the Prophet Muhammad. And these are the three most important writings of Islam: the Quran, the Hadith, the oral tradition, and the Sira, the biography of Muhammad. When we go to the Quran to check about Jerusalem, we find, amazingly, that Jerusalem does not appear in the Quran even one time. Not even one time. The Quran has nothing to do with Jerusalem at all. It's not mentioned. And Jerusalem has, in Arabic, four names. Al-Quds, which everybody knows, which is the modern name, which the Turkish gave Jerusalem as a short for another name, Bayt el-Maqdis. Bayt el-Maqdis came from, it's clear, Bayt HaMikdash. So Bayt el-Maqdis appears much in the Hadith, not in the Quran, in the Hadith, in all tradition, already in the ancient parts of the Hadith. Not, doesn't appear in the Quran. Another name of Jerusalem is Ilia, which is a short of Ilia Capitolina, the name which the Romans gave Jerusalem to denigrate the Jews. Not Ilia appears in the Hadith, not in the Quran. And then another name is the Christian name, Urshalim, which again, of course, doesn't appear in the Quran. So the Quran, since the Quran doesn't deal with Jerusalem, we have to go to the Hadith, to the secondary source, which has much about Jerusalem. But in order to understand what happens then with the Hadith, we have to look actually into the way how the Hadith was created. The Hadith is a series, not a very long series, of stories, anecdotes, reports about Muhammad and his companions. Why? Muhammad is viewed in the Quran, in Islam, as infallible, somebody who is directed by Allah Everything which he has done was directed by Allah. Allah kept him from making any mistake. This is why if a Muslim wants to behave in a way which with the best way means directed by Allah, he has to follow the behavior of Muhammad. This is why these stories about how he buttoned his shirt, which shoe he put first and which shoe he put second, anything in his life is important because this is the source of the Islamic halakha. After all, he was the role model of every Muslim in every time, in every place, and in every situation. This is why these stories are so important. And in every story, every anecdote about Muhammad and his companions actually has two parts. One part is the chain of narrators who were, it was in oral tradition, who actually passed the tradition from one to another. Parallel to us, Amar Rabbi Elazar, Amar Rabbi Akiva. The same thing which appears in the Mishnah and in the Talmud. The same mechanism. One rabbi, one narrator heard it from one, who heard it from one, who saw Muhammad doing this and that. So this is the chain of narrators, which call in Arabic Isnad, which I would say Isnad is the something which you lean on, something which you rely on. Okay, this is the chain. And the second part is the matn, means the content. How he buttoned his shirt, how he put his shoes, how he washed his hands, which first is... Okay, all these stories are very important because these are the source of halakha in Islam. However, since these stories were kept by heart, sometimes people remembered less than what they heard. You call it forgetting because it is oral tradition. So sometimes people forget. I forgot the ring to my wedding. Okay, people forget things. So it's okay, we are married very happily. Okay, but there are others who remember too much. And this is called forgery. Because if you heard 100 stories and you have in your memory 200 stories, where did another 100 come from? From your creative soul. Okay? So this is what I mean. And through the years of Islam, the hadith was oral for 200 years. And these years were very turbulent in Islam because of things which I'll talk about later. So everyone of those, or many of those who remember the hadith, concocted hadith in order to support all kinds of things. The main factory of hadith was the rift between the Sunni and the Shi'i Islam. Why? Because since Muhammad died, his cousin and son-in-law, Ali, means his cousin who married Muhammad's daughter, claimed that he should be the caliph. But the others who were around Muhammad didn't like him. He was young, he was stuttering, he had baby face. So they kicked him out, although he was beloved by Muhammad and married his daughter, and they gave it to others. Those who support Ali and his claim to power until the end of days are the Shia. Those who support those who took the caliph from Ali are the Sunnah. So the rift between the Sunnah and the Shia started more or less when Muhammad died and the struggle of the succession started. Now, what the Shia did, the people who believed in Ali, they created hadith. Somebody heard somebody, who heard Muhammad saying that Ali is the best man in our community. Another hadith, somebody, that Ali is the most reliable man. Another one, Ali is the most courageous man. Means a whole plethora of hadiths which all exalt Ali and praise him, everything of course quoted from Muhammad, that and therefore he should succeed me and he, his children, his grandchildren until the end of time. The Sunnah did not sit without doing anything. They also created hadith. Somebody heard somebody that Muhammad said that Ali is a crook, Ali cheated me with my daughter. Ali was cruel to her, kicking me away from any position. Ali was nothing. Ali is a liar. Okay? And books about the about Ali were authored by the Sunnah. Of course, everything is quoted from Muhammad against the Shia, against Ali. The Shia has whole books and books, a whole shelf of books, how Ali is the best man. And again, everything is quoted from Muhammad. Okay? So everyone who looks at these two bookshelves understands immediately that these bookshelves were created after Muhammad died, and in order to support the political approach, either for the Shia or against the Shia. And there were many other reasons why to create hadith. I'll give you one example just to show you. The first watermelons were brought to the Islamic world in the mid-9th century, 845 more or less. Merchants went to India, brought this nice vegetable, green outside, red inside, very attractive, very sweet, and they made good money, very good money, by the first shipment which came from India. However, you can sell a watermelon in high price only one time. Why? When you buy watermelon, you buy also the seeds. So what can you do now? You take all the seeds from the town, you plant them in your backyard, you water them. After 2-3 months, you have a whole backyard full of watermelons. What will happen to the price? Will drop. All of a sudden, there is a hadith which somebody heard, somebody who heard, somebody who heard, somebody who heard Muhammad saying that the price of a watermelon in the market cannot be less than 2 dirham, which is like a salary of a half of a month. Okay? He didn't see a watermelon in his life. How could he say anything about the price of watermelon in the market? Okay, so it is clear that this kind of hadith was created by the merchants of watermelons. Okay, and this is how the hadith became very, very big corpus of thousands and thousands of traditions, which many of them were created during these 200 years in order to promote all kinds of things, from sects like Shia in the Sunnah, even watermelons and many other things. Towards the mid-9th century, 9 scholars of hadith saw the situation and they decided that it cannot go on like this. They gave a hack in the standard and they say, enough. We have to clean the hadith from all the concoctions which were introduced into the hadith by all kinds of interests, the Sunnah, the Shia, and the others. And they developed a mechanism how to check the hadith, how to judge whether hadith is correct or not. They checked the line of the narrators, and they check in every line, every chain, every couple, the first and the second and the third, whether they lived in the same place, whether they lived in the same time, and whether the one who quotes actually took lessons from the one who is quoted. And if all these 3 questions were answered yes, 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 they went to the next couple. The one who quotes lived in the same place, in the same time, and did he take lessons from the one who is quoted? If yes, 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 they went to the next couple. This is how they checked the chains. And only chains which were continuous, they gave heksher to the hadith. But if they found that one lived in Istanbul and one lived in Cairo, the one who is quoted, and the third lived in Lebanon, and how could they quote each other? It's impossible, because those days they didn't have telephone, they didn't have fax, they didn't have email, they didn't have WhatsApp or Telegram or any modern ways of communication. So this hadith is evidently forged. Okay, this is the way how they judged the hadith, about by checking the chain of narrators. Where is the problem? Very soon after this checking started and the reliable chains were found, those who concocted hadith concocted hadith with reliable chains, with chains which got the seal of approval. So now you don't know whether what hadith, and they kicked out like more than 90% of the stories. Ladies and gentlemen, Muslims, very responsible or very worried about Islam, they did it in much of agony and much pain to declare that, yes, we have a lot of stuff which is forged. We have to get rid of it. And this happened 1,200 years ago. Okay? We have to salute them for the courage to come and say, yes, there are people within us who concocted hadith. And they left, everyone left behind him a book which contained only the reliable hadith which he thought to be reliable. Since they used the same method, they came to more or less the same book, and all these 9 books are considered as reliable books. Everything else is concoction, maybe concoction, for sure concoction, all kinds of epithets which they gave them, and they keep them up. Now, why do I elaborate so much about the hadith? Everything about Jerusalem in Islam comes from the hadith. So now we have to check it really, what is truth, what is not. And the modern research developed different ways how to evaluate hadith in order to come to the real story of the hadith. Not everything is, of course, is forged, but today the modern research developed different methods of how to judge the hadith in order to come to which hadith is accurate and which is forged. What I want to give you today is actually the, as they say in Hebrew, Girsa Efes, the zero version, means the real version of what happened with Islam, with Jerusalem in Islam, based on mosaic of hadith, like puzzle, which I would say from, imagine if you have a puzzle of 1,000 parts and you have 950. If you combine them in the good way, you do see the picture, although some parts are missing. So this is the picture which I would like to show you tonight, how Jerusalem became holy for Muslims, and now the lecture begins. So far it was the preamble for the preface. Professors usually speak in segments of an hour and a half. Ladies and gentlemen, the story, the untold story of Jerusalem in Islam. Our story starts in the Arab Peninsula, more or less in the year of 610. This today is Saudi Arabia. The Arab Peninsula is this, including Yemen and others. Eretz Israel is here. Our story starts in Mecca, in the year of 610, more or less. 610, parallel to our time, is after the Talmud was sealed, before the era of the Geonim started 200 years later. These 400 years are more or less a lacuna in Jewish sources, because nothing which was written in these 400 years was preserved. Since the Geonim started in 850 more or less, we have Jewish sources. But since the sealing of the Talmud in the 5th century until that 9th century, we have a gap of years which nobody knows really what was altered. And this is an era which we talk about. In Mecca is in that times the center of the Hijaz. Hijaz is the western part of the Saudi or the Arab Peninsula, the western part. Mecca is a central city of commerce and worshipping of an idol, a female idol, idolatry, named the Kaaba. The Kaaba, the black stone which the Muslims encircle today in the Hajj, was an idol for hundreds of years before Islam came to the world in the 7th century. The pagan Arabs believed that the Kaaba is the goddess which is in, who is in charge of fertility, means pregnancy, childbirth, and breastfeeding. This is, she is the one who is in charge of, because she looks like a big egg, which reminded them of a stomach of a lady who is pregnant. So this is why they worship the Kaaba in order to get pregnant and so forth. Kaaba at Mecca was a haram. Haram means a city where you are not allowed to come with your weapon. Means you come for commerce, you come for the Kaaba, you don't come for struggles and to fight, and you leave everything out. This is what the word haram means. And they were coming to worship the Kaaba. The Kohen of the Kaaba of those days, the custodian, was a guy, man, named Abdul Muttalib. He had a son named Abdallah. Abdallah means the servant of Allah. They knew about Allah as an abstract God, although they had also idols. Who is in heaven? Nobody sees him, nobody hears him, but he's there. Nobody really knows what his role is, but we heard about him for all kinds of Jews and Christians. And Abdallah was the son of the custodian of the Kaaba. Abdallah had a son, means the grandson of the custodian. The grandson was named Muhammad in his home. To their home, one day, in more or less 610, comes a Jewish rabbi who ran away from Yemen, from the south, apparently because he got in trouble with his community. And he settled in their home and started to sit with the young Muhammad and to tell him about the stories of the Bible. Tells him about Adam and Eve, that Adam was created from mud, and Eve was created from his rib, and what happened in Gan Eden, and Noah, and the Ark, and all these things. And Muhammad learns all these stories, and he believes in them, Allah of course, and he goes out to the streets of Mecca to spread the new belief in what Kaab tells him at home. He starts to talk to the Meccans about Gan Eden, about Adam and Eve, about the snake, about the people who were sinful, so Allah kicked them since they ate from the forbidden tree, and the people were sinful, and Allah decided to bring a tawafan to flood the whole world. So he brought the tawafan, and they told Nuh to build a tabut. You understand what I say, right? Noah to build a teiva, an ark, and he saved Noah and his wife and kids and some animals, and all and everybody else that flooded with the tawafan. And then came Abraham, and Abraham had two wives, Sarah and Hagar, and Sarah had a son named Ishaq, and Hagar had a son named Ismail, and Ishaq had a son named Yaqub, and Yaqub had 12 asbat, shvatim, and one of them was Yusuf, and father Jacob made him a nice garment, and he dreamt about the sun and the moon and the stars who all worship him. And father warned him, don't say to your brothers, they will hate you. And he told them to the brothers, and they hated him. And they once abducted him to the field, and they threw him into the pit, and they sold him to a convoy of Midianim, and they took him to Egypt and sold him there. And there he had this affair with a lady, so the master of the kicked him to the jail, and in jail there were two servants of Pharaoh, who dreamt about, one is squeezing the all the stories which we know from the story of Joseph, and then came other, and the Pharaoh was dreaming about seven cows, the seven wheats, and all these things, whatever, the same thing. Compare exactly all the stories. And then the Israelites came to Egypt, and they were saved by Allah from the Ubudiyat Faraon, in slavery to Pharaoh, and Allah took them, redeemed them to the desert, and then they were afraid to go into Eretz Israel because there are giants in Eretz Israel, and they were afraid of them, what is Parashat Shlach, and about the prophets, and David, and Solomon, and Zechariah, and Isaiah, and all, and of course, Jesus Christ, he knows about also, and he, means Muhammad, when he tells them all these stories, he also demands all kinds of demands, that they will stop. He told them also about the Gan Eden, the Gehenom, means the paradise and the hell, and the reward for the righteous ones, and the punishments for the wicked ones. And he also demanded that the people of Mecca stop burying the daughters alive. They had this practice in order to reduce the population of women, and they were burying the daughters alive. And he actually dedicated a whole chapter in the Quran against it, because it was inhumane to treat newborns, females, in such a way. He calls upon them to stop selling slaves. They were catching people in the desert and bring them to the slave market and selling them, men, women. Now, how do you sell a person in the slave market? You stripped him or her totally, because who wants to buy something which is in wrapping? We want to see the merchandise. Okay, very humiliating. And he shouts at them, how can you do such a thing to creatures of Allah who are like you exactly? Creatures of Allah, who gives you the permission to sell people in such a humiliating way? And he, of course, doesn't like the fact that they are cheating in commerce. They have a heavy kilo for purchasing and a light kilo for selling, and they were making money on the difference. Oh, they were crooks, and this also he preaches against it. He actually wants to bring some tikkun olam to Mecca, to the way which people were behaving in this place. After all, he learned from Kaab. Kaab was the name of the Jew who came to his home. When the Meccans heard all these stories from Muhammad, they looked at him, excuse us? These stories, we know those stories from the Jews and the Christians. You are actually, what you try to sell us is Asatir al-Awwalin. Asatir al-Awwalin in Arabic is, I would say, the stories or the fables or the mises of the first ones or the old ones, means the Jews and Christians. You actually recycle Jewish and Christian sources. You plagiarize. Whatever you came to us with, it's all copied. And this allegation that the whole Quran is plagiarized from Jewish and Christian sources appears in the Quran 11 times. 11 times the Quran quotes the people of Mecca telling Muhammad that all he's doing is copy and paste from Jewish sources. Well, you know what I mean. Okay? This is the worst thing which you can tell somebody who comes with a new gospel, new idea, tries to correct the world, and people tell you, what do you mean? You copy it. We know exactly. They made fun of it. Not only this, after 12 years of activity, where his success was very limited, he succeeded to convert maybe some dozens of people, not more. They even tried to kill him because he made people too angry. And after 3 or 4 attempts to kill him, he understood that he cannot anymore live in Mecca because he will be killed by the Meccans and this will be the end of him. So he runs away In the year of 622, 12 years after he started his activity, to Medina, which is here, like 180 kilometers to the north from Mecca. In Medina, he comes, and immediately he becomes a judge. Why? He's a stranger. He doesn't know one for another. So he can be an honest judge. He doesn't have any friends in this place. So, and you know, if a judge knows one of the sides, he should decline from that file. But since he doesn't know anybody, he can be honest judge. So he became the judge of his district in the city or the area where he lived. Then he became the supreme judge of the whole city. Afterwards, he becomes the ruler, actually, of his neighborhood. And after 2 years, since he came to Medina, he became the ruler of the whole city. Definitely an upgrade compared to what he was in Mecca. Because in his home, a town means built place, he was humiliated, he was laughed at, he was chased and maybe murdered. And here in Medina, he becomes the ruler of Medina after he became a judge. So definitely, but he wanted not only to be the master of the place. Thank you so much. You know, in the desert, water is very important. He didn't want only to rule Medina. He wanted also to convert the people of Medina to Islam. Because they were also, part of them were pagans, and part of them were Jewish. More or less half of the population of Medina was Jewish. And all of them were descendants of a part of tribe named Banu Quraiza. This is the name of the tribe, of the Jewish tribe who lived in Medina. He approaches them to convince them to convert to Islam. Why? If Jews give up on their religion and convert to Islam, Islam evidently is a better religion. So it will ease on him to convert the pagans. So he first approaches the Jews. Who approaches the Jews? Who did the job? Kaab, his mentor, is the Yemenite rabbi. He went to the Jews in Medina and started to talk to them. Maybe they will convert. So they say, look, all what Muhammad has, he learned from you. Means he has the copy. Why should we leave the original and convert to the copy? If he wants to be like us, he should convert to Judaism. And we'll accept him. Of course, Muhammad didn't like it. He was very angry when he heard this story or this demand of the Jews. And he started to hate them. But in order to convince them, the first stage, he directed the prayer to Jerusalem up north. Because Jerusalem is to the north. From Medina, it's here. As if saying to them, hey, you pray to Jerusalem, I pray to Jerusalem, let's unite and come under my aegis and we'll pray to Jerusalem together. They didn't buy and they didn't convert to Islam. Although he was praying to Jerusalem around a year and a half, 16, 17 months, he was praying to Jerusalem, but they didn't convert to Islam. He got very angry at them at some point. So he burnt their trees, which they were making living on. It didn't work. So he burnt their houses. It didn't work. So he slaughtered the men, the males, and he took all the women. One of his wives, Safiya, was one of the daughters of one of the leaders of the Quraida Jewish tribe. She was 14. He married her. And he consummated the marriage immediately in his tent. After all, she was a widow from engagement because he slaughtered her fiancé right in front of her eyes. So, since there were no Jews anymore, after all the males were slaughtered, he did the same thing to two different Jewish tribes who lived near Medina. One was named Banu Kainuka, means the sons of Kainuka, and the other one was Banu Nadir. So he slaughtered all these three Jewish tribes who lived around Medina, and since then there is no point to pray toward Jerusalem because there are not any more Jews to convince to convert to Islam. So then the ayah, means the the pasuk, the verse descends upon him from Allah, of course, to direct the prayer down south to Mecca. Later in 630, he occupies Mecca, burns all the idols, keeps the Kaaba because the Kaaba was too important for the people, because she's in charge of something very important. And Jerusalem was abandoned in his life, which he never came out from the Arab Peninsula. And this is what we have to do. So this is the role of Jerusalem in the days of Muhammad himself, a direction of prayer for a year and a half almost. That's all, which was canceled later. In the first time in Mecca, between 610 and 22, he used to go to the town of Taif, which you can see to the east from Mecca. Because in Taif also he had a little community of supporters, and used to go to visit them and maybe collect some support. The way to Taif takes a day and a half of walk. Day and a half. Between a day and a half, there is a night. Until this very day. And at night, you don't want to stay outside in the desert, because you will be devoured either by four-legged animals, tigers, all kinds of others, and or by two-legged animals who will catch you to sell you to slavery and will take your camel or your horse or your donkey and annex them to their fleet of camels and so forth. So between the four-legged and the two-legged animals, you do not want to stay in the desert by yourself. You have to spend the night in a place where people live, and they protect you as they protect themselves from the same animals. And sure enough, according to Islamic sources, more or less between Mecca and Taif, there is a village named Jurana. Very important to remember these names, because these are actually the important details. This is Google Maps from the days of Muhammad. Well, the landscape did not change dramatically. What you see today is only the roads which the Saudis paved. Most probably on ancient roads, because this is always what people do. So this is the from the space. This is Mecca, as you can see. This is Taif. And this is Jurana. See? Jurana, Mecca, and Taif. Muhammad used to go to Jurana the half day, sleep in Jurana, wake up in the morning, and go for a whole day walk to Taif. Back he went whole day from Taif to Jurana, spend the night in Jurana, and walk for half day to Mecca. This was the day and a half, and the night he spent in Jurana, because in Jurana there also was a group of Muslims, followers, who gave him shelter to the night in the place which they lived. In the morning, when he woke up, he used to pray in one of two mosques which the Muslims of Jurana built near the village. One was closer to the village, so they named it the Closer Mosque, Al-Masjid Al-Adna in Arabic. The other one was further from the village, so they named it the Further Mosque, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, Al-Adna Al-Aqsa. This is in Arabic, the Closer and the Further. The Further Mosque was in the other side of the valley, which was near the village. One morning, he wakes up in Mecca, which he calls the Holy Mosque, and a new revelation descended upon him during that night. And he cites it to his followers. And this verse actually appears in the Quran, chapter 17, verse 1, which says, in English or in Arabic? Both. Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan. Glory to him who took his servant laylan, means at night, in spite of the dangers, those with two and those with four legs, from the min al-masjid al-haram, from the holy mosque, il al-masjid al-aqsa, to the further mosque, alladhi barakna hawlahu, which we, means the deity, which we blessed its surroundings, linuriyahu min ayatina, in order to show him our wonders, ala huwa as-sami' al-basir, since Allah hears and sees everything. Glory to him who took his servant at night from the holy mosque to the furthest mosque, to the further mosque, which we blessed its surroundings in order to show him our wonders, since he hears and sees everything. This is the verse in the Quran. And he tells it to his followers. They know exactly where the Al-Aqsa Mosque is. Half a day walk. And Allah gave him such a miracle during one night, in spite of the dangers, those with four legs and those with two legs, in spite of all these dangers, Allah took him all the way to Jerusalem and back during one night, and he woke up in his bed with his pajama, safe and sound, and his wife swears that he didn't get out from bed through the whole night. What a miracle! This is the story as it is in the Quran. They didn't make a big issue out of it, because they were used to all kinds of miracles which happened to him, and they continue with their routine. Muhammad died in 632 in Medina. Since then started the days of the caliph, the era of the caliphs. First caliph was Abu Bakr, the first Muslim, first man who believed in Muhammad, means the oldest in Islam. And he was the caliph for 2 years. A snake bit him and he died. 634. Then the successor was Umar, the combatant, the warrior of the commander of the army, because those days they had some problems with some tribes which tried to get out of Islam. And they had to be coerced back into Islam. And Umar controls Islam for 10 years, since 634 to 44. And he actually is the one who bursts to the north and occupies the Sham area. Sham means what today is Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, and Eretz Israel. Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, and Eretz Israel. This area is the Sham. This area is being occupied by the Muslims between 34 and 634 and 44, the 10 years which Umar controlled Islam. They put siege on Jerusalem in October 637. October means it's almost the winter. Jerusalem in those days is controlled by the Christian Byzantines, and the one who is in charge of Jerusalem is the bishop Sophronius, the last bishop of Jerusalem, Byzantine. And he sees these Muslims around him, and it's October, and the siege which they put over Jerusalem. And he hopes that the winter, which starts more or less in those days, will fill all the cisterns of Jerusalem with enough water so they can survive in the summer when there is no rain. Unfortunately, apparently the winter of that year was not as he expected. And towards April, towards the end of the winter, he sees the cisterns and he sees that they are more or less half filled. Means they will not stay in the city if under siege. People have to drink, people have to, some water actually evaporates. So he understood that he cannot survive, he will not survive. And whenever the Muslims occupy a city by force, they slaughter the men and they take the women. So he didn't want to be slaughtered. You know, it's not so comfortable. And he decided in April of 638 to surrender. He opens the gate, goes out, hoping that nothing will happen to him, demands to sit with Umar, the caliph himself, not with any deputy or any other, was to the boss, sits with him, and of course signs on the surrender without any pressure. He couldn't say anything, whatever. Umar imposed on him tax and everything. He agreed with no other choice. And after he signs, they shake hands, and he invites Umar to come to the city, into the city, as a conqueror without any fight. Of course, Umar accepts the invitation, takes his entourage after Sophronius into the city. In the entourage, there is a very important person, Ka'ab, the Jewish mentor of Muhammad. He lived after Muhammad, and he came to Jerusalem with the entourage, or within the entourage of Umar entering the city for the first time. Ladies and gentlemen, the Byzantines did not allow Jews to enter Jerusalem for hundreds of years. Hundreds of years, Jews were abandoned in Jerusalem. They could not come to Jerusalem openly, maybe some sneaked into, but not overtly. Ka'ab was apparently the first Jew who was allowed to go into Jerusalem with permission, because he was one of the entourage of the conqueror, Umar. They go to the tour in the city, and they are about to enter the Temple Mount. Ka'ab takes off his shoes. Why? There is a verse in Sefer Shemot, Shal na'alecha me'al raglecha, כי המקום אשר אתה עומד עליו, אדמת קודש הוא. Take your shoes off your feet, because the place which you are stepping on is a holy place. What happened to Moses in the desert, in front of the bush? So, similarly, Ka'ab takes off his shoes and carries them in his hands. Umar, the caliph, sees him with the shoes in his hands. Ask him, what is this? Why do you carry your shoes in your hands? So Ka'ab says, this is a holy place. Umar looks at him, very angry, and says, you are trying to push Jewish ideas into our religion. You immediately put these shoes on before I get angry at you. Now Ka'ab knew that whenever Umar gets angry at somebody, this somebody is losing, very fast, is losing the connection between his head and shoulders. And he didn't want to lose, you know, it's important, connection. So, forced by Umar, Ka'ab puts his shoes and goes into the Temple Mount with shoes. Now, this anecdote, this story, what does it tell us? What do we understand from this? That Umar, the one who is in charge of Islam, doesn't know that Temple Mount is a holy place. Okay? And he lived with Muhammad like brothers. Means he didn't hear from Muhammad that this place is holy. Let's say he forgot. Ka'ab reminds him with the shoes. If he heard from Muhammad that this place is holy, he himself would take off his shoes. No, he would tell everybody, take off the shoes. Ka'ab reminded me. But this is not what happened. What happened is the opposite, that he forces Ka'ab to wear the shoes because he does not accept the fact that that place is holy. This was the year of 638. Now, not only this, when they go into the Temple Mount, Umar asks Ka'ab, where did the Jews pray when they were here? Because Ka'ab tells him this was the Beit Mikdash. So he tells him that the Jews were praying in the north, in the northern part of the Temple Mount. Why? Because they pray to the south, to Mecca. This way they will pray towards the place where the temple was. A tricky way. Okay? So, Umar again tells him, you are trying to push Jewish issues. We will pray from the south to Mecca, to the south, turning our back to the center of the Temple Mount, which was once the temple. We will not pray from the north with our face to the place of the temple. We'll pray from the south, where our back are for the, to the temple, which is behind us. Okay? So everything which Kab tries to push into Islam as a Jewish thing, Omar negates and does the opposite in order not to allow any connection with Judaism and the holy places of Jerusalem, especially this place. So this shows us, all these stories, that in the year of 638, when Jerusalem was occupied, by not by force, by surrender, it was not yet considered holy for Muslims. Fast forward, Umar was murdered in 644. After him was the third caliph, Uthman, who was murdered in 656. And after him was finally Ali, the founder of the Shia. He became the caliph in 56. But immediately a rebellion started against Ali. And the rebel was actually the governor of the Sham, of this part. He was subordinate to the caliph, and he was the governor of the Sham. His name was Muawiyah. Muawiyah, his clan was the Umayyad clan, the branch of the Quraysh tribe of Muhammad. And he, the Muawiyah, rebels against Ali, the fourth caliph, and declares himself as the caliph. Ali, in 661, was murdered, so Muawiyah became the caliph, because now there was no struggle anymore. Ali was murdered, the fourth caliph, so Muawiyah became the governor of the Sham, becomes the caliph, the fifth caliph. Once he became the caliph, he moves the capital city from Medina to Damascus, where he is already for 20 years the governor, because all of the officers, all the administration, everything is concentrated in Damascus, and he didn't have anybody in Medina, so all his family and cousins, those who controlled the Sham for him, were in Damascus, so he had nothing with Medina. He moves the capital to Damascus. Not only this, Medina is in the desert. Those days they already occupy Iraq. In order to go from Medina to Iraq, it's like 10 days walk. You have to load your camel with so much water, so much food for both of you, you and the camel, so you cannot anymore ride it. You have to walk because the camel is too much, has too heavy of a load. It's not practical to govern such a place like Iraq from Medina. And to the west, there is a sea, the Red Sea. Those years, they don't know yet how to build ships, so they cannot cross the sea. They will learn it later when they will go to Europe from Morocco today in the year of 711. So until then, they don't know yet how to build ships. So Medina is actually in the middle of nowhere. You cannot go to the east to Iraq. You cannot go to the west to the sea. So there is useless when the empire goes bigger. So he moved them. Another is why to move the capital to Damascus. Here you go to the Euphrates, and you go down with the Euphrates to wherever you like. Your camel can drink from the river, can eat grass from the river. Two people can ride the camel or the horse. Okay, it's much easier, much more logical from the logistics point of view to run the empire from Damascus, not from Medina. So the people in Medina, which were actually make living out of convoys and everything, they are very angry at this because he took their all the parnasa, and he takes it to, but he couldn't care less about them. And Damascus becomes the capital. Within a few years, Damascus becomes the richest town in the whole world, because everywhere when they found churches, abbeys, monasteries, and sanctuaries of the Persians in Iraq and forward, and of course private assets, they loot, they take to Bayt al-Mal. Bayt al-Mal means the house of the money or the property. And tons of gold, silver, copper, and many other things which they looted wherever they went, because Allah gave them all the countries, because they are Muslims and the others are infidels. And they distribute whatever they took to the Khavre, to the combatants. And they, you know, build buildings of bricks and live like nouveau riche, life of, you know, a very lucrative life. And after all, they have all the property which they looted. And they play with water, because in Damascus there is a river named Barada, and they pull, everyone pulls a little river into his property, into his living room, and out. So imagine, somebody sits in his couch in the living room with his feet in the water. What can be better? And the fish inside, you know, with nets here and there. And life of nouveau riche, of lucrative life. But this was not the only problem. They were still drinking, as they did before Islam came to the world, because it is very, very hard to convince a full society to stop drinking after they drank for generations alcoholic beverages. And they were continued drinking to a degree that there were stories about some caliphs from the Umayyads who were seldom found sober, to that degree. Just imagine running a state when you are drunk. Not only this, most of the men were in the battlefields, in the east, already in Persia, what Iran is today. In the west, they went to North Africa, where Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, and the number of men, of males, in Damascus was one of 20 from the number of women, because the men, the husbands, went to the war. Now, those days, they didn't have any communications. They didn't have trains, they didn't have airplanes. So when somebody went to the war, which is thousands of miles to the east or to the west, usually he lost the connection, because there are no phone, no fax, no email, no WhatsApp, no trains, and no planes. So how can you keep connection with your wife if you don't come to vacation? And this was the situation. Walking all this way took months. So there were many, many women in Damascus who know nothing about their husbands. Are they alive? Are they not? The husbands in the battlefield don't know if their wives are alive. So the detachment between the men and women created a situation where the few men in Damascus felt very comfortable to have everything which they want with every woman, because there are no men. Okay, so imagine a sin city like Damascus with alcoholic beverages which stream over in every place, very rich, nouveau riche, and women are easy prey to every man who was there, and the women are not afraid, because their husbands, if they still alive, they are thousands of kilometers fighting against the Persians there or the others there. So this was the situation in Damascus. And not only this, in the year of 680, something tremendous happened in the town of Karbala, here, not far from here, in southern Iraq. The son of Ali, Hussein ben Ali, was hiding there in the swamps of southern Iraq. And he does not accept the rule of the Umayyads. And he was actually a rebel. So the caliph, Yazid ben Muawiyah, sent a unit to catch him. And they actually caught him and they killed him. But they didn't have on those days cameras to prove that the mission is accomplished. So how can they prove it? They beheaded Hussein ben Ali and they brought the head to Damascus to show the caliph. Now, the caliph didn't have television those days, or newspapers, or even radio. So how can he publicize the fact that Hussein bin Ali, the rebel, is murdered, is killed? So he kept his head, the head on his desk, for a whole month. Imagine the smell, though it was open. So it could be. So everyone who comes sees what is there, and leman yiru veyirau. So they see and they get careful, and they behave. Okay, because this is what happens to anyone who tries to do something against the regime. Now, this man, Hussein bin Ali, was actually the grandson of Muhammad, because Ali married Muhammad's daughter, Fatma, and this was their son. Means, this is what you do to the grandson of Muhammad? And this, what he did, actually raised the whole wave of resentment against the caliph, because even those who did not support the demand of the Shia to government, yet they didn't support this deed. Okay, so they were drunk, they were immersed in adultery, and they were killers. And Hussein bin Ali, how did they allow themselves to behave in such an un-Islamic way? The alcohol is forbidden, killing is forbidden, and adultery is also forbidden. How can they allow themselves to behave in such a way? Well, there is a hadith which says that heard Muhammad saying that anyone who comes to Hajj with full intention and a pure heart, all his sins are being cleansed, and he gets out from the Hajj as clean as a baby who is just born. Great. We can celebrate everything in Damascus through the whole year. We can have whatever we like, drink and whatever. We can kill here and there. We'll go once a year to Mecca, to Hajj. We'll run the spin around the Kaaba. We'll say, Labayka Allahumma Labayka, means we obey you, Allah, we obey you. And all the sins will be cleansed, and we can go to Damascus to continue what we stopped a week earlier. Okay, what Rambam says, Echtav Yashem. In the year of 682, 2 years after the beheading of Hussein bin Ali, a guy in Mecca stood up and said, enough is enough. You, the people from the Sham, you are coming to Hajj when you are stinking of alcoholic beverages. You cannot even walk straight. And I know what you have, the hip flasks which you hold in your suits. This is not Hajj. This is a joke, what you do. This is not real. Stay out. First, repent. Stop drinking. Stop fooling around with the wives of the combatants. Stop killing. Then come to Hajj. And he cuts the ways in front of their faces. By the way, it reminds us of Isaiah. Isaiah, first chapter, which says to the people of Judea, כי תבואו לראות פניי, מי ביקש זאת מידכם, רמוס חצריי. When you come to see my face, who asked you to come to step on my grass? רחצו, הזכו, wash yourself, purify yourself, stop sinning before you come to pilgrimage to the temple. Okay, this is what Isaiah says to the Israelites of his days. The same thing, Abdallah ibn Zubair, the guy in Mecca, tells the people from Medina, from Damascus, go away, repent, stop drinking, stop killing, stop the adultery, then you come to Hajj. Otherwise, stay out. So they couldn't go to the Hajj. They went to the caliph, and they said, Gewalten geschrieben, the man doesn't let us to go to Hajj, and we have many sins to clean. But the caliph couldn't do anything because half of his army is in Iran, where Iran today is, in the east. Half, the other half of the army is going to the west, where Morocco is. And the few policemen which he has in Damascus are either drunk or very tired. So how can they fight those Bedouins who are still big fighters, good fighters, when all these ex-fighters in Damascus are immersed in alcohol, immersed in whatever they do there, and they became so weak, so fat, so ineffective when it comes to fight in the desert. Forget it, they cannot fight. So for 10 years, they could not defeat their rebellion in Mecca, and they could not go to Hajj in Mecca. 10 years. But Hajj is one of the five pillars of Islam, one of the five most important commandments. How can they not go? They have to find some alternative. So the caliph collected his wise men, the ulama, those who are concocting hadith all the day against the Shia, to consultation, what to do with the situation. So they tell him, look, we have many Jews who converted to Islam in order to get rid of the taxes which you put on them. There are many Christians who converted to Islam for the same reason. Jerusalem is under our hands. The history of Jerusalem as a holy city is in our streets because of the mass conversion of Jews and Christians. Let's convert the Hajj to Jerusalem, because we control Jerusalem. So said, hey, Jerusalem is not mentioned in the Quran. How can we do it? You remember that verse? Glory to him who took his servant at night from the holy mosque to the further mosques. Let's tell everybody that the further mosque, means Al-Aqsa, is in Jerusalem. Nobody knows about Jorana, about that village. Nobody knows, because nobody goes there to Hajj. Everybody goes to Mecca. And the people in our area do not know this story about Jorana, that the Al-Aqsa is actually there. Let's say that the Al-Aqsa, which is mentioned in the Quran, is actually in Jerusalem. And we will take vacation from authoring hadith against the Shia, and we will start authoring hadith about Jerusalem. So first of all, they take this verse, and they author a new exegesis to this story, which is in short says, heard Muhammad saying that Al-Burak was brought to me. Al-Burak, according to some commentators, are a mule, female mule, with wings. Another group of commentators say that this is a female mule, no wings, but her hoofs reach the horizon. Such long hoofs. I rode her, and she immediately brought me to Jerusalem. There I met the Gabriel, the angel. He gave me a test of prophecy. I passed it. And he took me into the Haram, means into the Temple Mount. We prayed a short prayer, and he took me to the first heaven. Knocked at the door. A sound asked him, who is this? He says, Gabriel. Who is with you? Muhammad. Was he invited? Yes. The door opens, and there is Adam, the first human being. He is the custodian of the first heaven. He welcomed me and blessed me, and we together went to the second heaven. Gabriel knocks at the door, somebody says, who is this? So says, Gabriel, who is with you? Muhammad. Was he invited? Yes. The door opens, and there are the two cousins, Yahya and Isa. Who are these? Yahya, Johannes. Isa, Jesus. The cousins means the sons of the aunt. Cousins, and the sons of the aunt Miriam, the sister of Moses and Aaron. Do you have a proof that it's not this? They blessed me, wished me good luck, and took us to the third heaven. Who is this? Muhammad invited? Yes. The door opens in the third heaven. And who is there? Yusuf. Joseph. Sadiq. righteous man, brought me in, wished me good luck, and took us all to the fourth heaven. The whole story again. Who is there, the custodian? Seth, the son of Adam. Also, Seth. Welcome me, wished me good luck, and took us to the fifth heaven. The whole story again. Who is there? Aaron, Harun, the custodian of the fifth heaven. Sadi. Who took us to the sixth heaven? And there the custodian is Moses, Musa. And he took us to the seventh heaven, where the custodian is Ibrahim. Means Abraham al-Khalil. Means the Khalil, the companion of Allah. And he took us to the throne of Allah. And Allah gave me the commandment of the tefillah, the prayer. And here comes the strawberry on the cake. And I prayed in front of everybody. Now, this is the most important part of the story. Why? The one who leads the tefillah in Islam is not the one who has good voice, and not the one who knows the nosach, and not the official chazan, and not one who has yahrzeit or year of mourning. The only one who is allowed to lead the prayer is the ruler, the political leader. It's a state and mosque in Islam. He is the only one who is allowed. But if you went somewhere, somebody who is nominated by the caliph or by the ruler of the city to replace him in the prayer. Whoever tries to lead the prayer without an order is considered as a rebel against the government. This is how these things is. So, when Muhammad tells or says that I prayed in front of everybody, meaning Moses from the sixth heaven and Jesus from the second heaven, who prayed behind him, what does it mean? That he is now the ruler. And they, when they pray behind him, they actually accept him as the leader. And this event is, I would say, the establishing event of Islam. Because this puts Islam not as a asatir al-awwalin, copy and paste from the former religions. This put the Islam in totally different status as the higher of all the religions. The real religion, while Judaism and Christianity are null and void as of that moment, because the prophets of Judaism and Christianity, Moses and Jesus, actually accepted the leadership of Muhammad in that event in heaven. This is why it is so important, this story, because it gives Islam the seal of approval of Din al-Haq, means religion of truth, while Judaism and Christianity, as of that moment, become Din batil, means religion of falsehood or null and void. And this event, which actually gives Islam the seal of approval, or Hersher, this is the only religion in the world. By the way, it said in the Quran that Inna din inda Allah al-Islam, the religion at Allah's is Islam. No Judaism, not Christianity, not any other religion, only Islam. And this state in the Quran, which supports this idea that Islam came to the world to replace Judaism and Christianity. And this event, which gives Islam the superiority over everything in the world, is connected to Jerusalem. Because Muhammad came to heaven from Jerusalem, not from Mecca. So where will you go to Hajj? Jerusalem. So this is the story which is invented because of the rebellion in Mecca in order to convince the people to come to Hajj, to Jerusalem, rather than going to Mecca, because Mecca was closed. Okay? So this is one of the most, I would say, important stories which meant to inflate Jerusalem on the expense of Mecca. And they author thousands of stories like this. I'll give you one or two, for example. Somebody, Muhammad says that if a man, or anybody, prays in a mosque, he has his reward. If he prays in Mecca, he has seven times the reward. If he prays in Jerusalem 77 times the reward, and if there is very hot sun or rain or snow falls on him, his reward is 777 times in Jerusalem. So evidently Jerusalem is holier than Mecca. So where will you go to Hajj? Okay, this is one example of hadith which is concocted in those days in order to establish the idea that Jerusalem is a better place for Hajj than Mecca, and many more hadiths I won't tell you. And it worked, and there were some people who came to Hajj to Jerusalem. After 10 years of rebellion in Mecca in 692, they had enough power and they went to Mecca and they killed Abdullah ibn Zubair, the rebel. They crucified him and they beheaded him. This is not a practice which was invented by ISIS. It was already in the 7th century made by the Caliph Yazid bin Muawiyah. And the Hajj went back to Mecca. All these stories about Jerusalem were abandoned to the side, and the whole thing was forgotten. Until the days of the Crusaders in the 12th century, when Saladin came with his army and defeated the Crusaders in Karnei Chitin near Tveria, then he went to Jerusalem. He again sold these stories to his soldiers in order to inflame them against the Byzantines, and it worked, and they succeeded to defeat them, and Jerusalem was reoccupied by the Muslims. And there were people who still came to Hajj dozens of years after this event. Therefore, Ibn Taymiyyah, who lived in the between the 13th and 14th century, authored the book. This Ibn Taymiyyah, the guy whom I talked before, he authored the book which forbids coming to Jerusalem for Hajj, forbids performing the ceremonies of the Hajj in Jerusalem, forbids going to sleep in Jerusalem in order to get cured from all kinds of illnesses and problems in the body. So, if he forbids it, means that there were people who still were doing it. Okay, otherwise he wouldn't forbid it. And it worked very well. And in 1875, to a degree that in 1875, the Temple Mount was viewed by a camera of those days like this. This is a picture from 1875. Look at the floor. What does this floor tell us? Without words. That this place is almost abandoned. Because in Jerusalem you cannot have such height of grass or weed growing if people go there. Okay? This is clear evidence that in that year, 1875, the place was almost abandoned. Nobody really went there regularly. The British occupied Jerusalem in 1917 from the Ottoman Empire, and they nominate the Mufti, Haj Amin al-Husseini, as the one in charge of Jerusalem, and he, the Mufti, discovers immediately the potential of Jerusalem as a city for tourism. He authors this booklet, I have here the original, A Brief Guide to Al-Haram and Sharif Jerusalem, published by the Supreme Muslim Council, which he presided. It cost 150 mils. You know what it means? 15 pence. Okay? And this one, which I show you, it was published in Jerusalem 1929. I have the version of 1930, which is the same. What does he write in this booklet? Page number 4, he talks about the Haram, means the court of the Temple Mount, historical sketch. We won't read the whole thing, we'll read only 2 sentences. Look at him. It's here. Its identity with the site of Solomon's temple is beyond dispute. The identity of the Haram al-Sharif with Solomon's temple is beyond dispute. This too is the spot according to the universal belief, means the Islamic world as well, universal belief, on which, and here he quotes from Samuel, 2 Samuel book, David built an altar unto the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. This is what the Mufti wrote in this booklet. Ladies and gentlemen, this Mufti was probably the biggest and the worst Jew hater in the 20th century. He is the one who arranged the massacres against the Jews in 1920, 1921, 1929, in Hebron, in Jerusalem, in Yafo, in Tzfat, in Tveria. And those Jews were not Zionists. They were from the Yeshuva Yashan, Haredi Jews, whom they massacred, especially in Hebron. He incited the Arabs in these cities against the Jews. He arranged the Big Arab Revolt between 1936 and 1939. The British wanted to catch him, so he ran to Iraq, and he was in Baghdad, incited the Baghdadis against the Jews, and in 1941, Chag Shavuot, they massacred the Jews of Baghdad. 179 people, men and women, were slaughtered in Baghdad. Kids were amputated. Girls were humiliated in 2 days of riots against the Jews in Baghdad because of the incitement of the Mufti, the Palestinian Mufti who created the Palestinian national movement. So he ran away from there and he went to Hitler, and he became one of the closest friends of Hitler. There are all kinds of rumors about his participation in convincing Hitler to go for the final solution in 1941, but definitely 1944, he took active role in the extermination of almost 500,000 Jews in Hungary, because when the Nazis collected the Jews in Hungary in 1944 in Budapest, they wanted to take them to Auschwitz to be exterminated, but they were afraid that partisans would blow up the bridges of the trains. So the Mufti went to Yugoslavia, to Bosnia, and he went to Bulgaria, and he recruited some 30,000 Muslims to the Waffen-SS to guard the bridges, so those Jews will safely be brought to Auschwitz to be exterminated. This is what the Mufti did in order to get rid of the Jews in the whole world. He supported the Nazis as he did. So, but this Jew hater had no problem to write in this book that the Temple Mount is the place of the Solomon's Temple, and even David, his father, offered peace offerings. Okay, this what he wrote. Today, when you listen to their speakers, the music is totally, totally different. Let me show you a clip. I don't have it in English translation, but I will translate it to English. This is some years ago, after some days of riots in Jerusalem.
לפעמים דווקא כשלא קורה משהו מיוחד, זו גם כותרת חדשותית, ולכן החדשות של היום מירושלים, שאין חדשות, אחרי יומיים של מתיחות והתפרויות, היה היום שקט בבירה ובמתחם הר הבית. אלפי השוטרים שהוצבו בשכונות במזרח הרי נתקלו בעיקר בחיי יומיום, בלי אירועים חריגים.
What she says that after a few days of riots in Jerusalem, today life is more or less calm, and...
אנחנו תהינו, ממה בכלל נובעת המתיחות הזאת, ולמה דווקא עכשיו היא מתפרצת?
Why is this tension in Jerusalem, and why particularly now it erupts?
חבר הכנסת אחמד טיבי הסביר לנו שהמתפללים המוסלמים זוהמים על ההחלטה להגביל את גיל המתפללים בהר הבית למעל 50.
כנסת ממבר טיבי explained to us that the Muslims are outraged because the Israeli police restricted the age of those who come to the Al-Aqsa to 50 and above. Means they don't let the youngsters to come because the youngsters are throwing stones and all kinds of things. The question is why? If the youngsters are making tzores, why should they be allowed? Why are they outraged when Israel restricts the age of those who come to the Al-Aqsa Mosque? The answer is the religious problem which they have with us. According to Islam, Jews should live under the Islamic yoke as dhimmis. Ahl dhimma, as they say in Arabic, means people who live under the auspice of Islam. A Jew cannot ride a horse, only a donkey, in order to denigrate him. A Jewish home should be lower than the Islamic home. A Jewish synagogue should be lower than the mosque. A Jew and a Christian should pay jizya, means skull tax, when they are humiliated, as it states in the Quran. Means crawling on the floor, give the money from their hand and get kicked out from the room. A Jew and a Christian has to go off the sidewalk and walk in the sewage canal in the street when a Muslim comes in front of them, if he doesn't have enough space, if they stay on the sidewalk. And the sewage canal in the Middle Ages was collecting everything from the homes and not only from the kitchen. And this is where the Jew and the Christian had to walk, while the Muslim should walk on the clean and dry sidewalk. This is the rules of the Zimma. Jews have no right to a state, Jews have no right to an army, police, or any manifestation of independence and sovereignty. And here the Jewish police tells us, Muslims, who can come into the Temple Mount or to the Aqsa or not, who is not. It is against the rules of physics if Jews tell us what to do and what not to do. This is why they are outraged when the Jewish police says, you yes and you no.
כל המועד ומהאמירות של גורמים מהימין לפיהן יש להפוך את מסגד אל-אקצה מאתר מוסלמי לאזור דתי יהודי מוסלמי.
They hear that all kinds of people from the Israeli right side of the political map call to change the status of the Temple Mount from an Islamic place to a Jewish Islamic place, like what happened in Marat HaMachpela in Hebron.
אנחנו אסחב אל-בית.
The one who speaks is Ikrim Asabri, the Mufti of today, of those days. Nahnu Ashab al-Bayt, we are the owners of the place, means not you. The journalist asked him, what do you think the Jews are trying to do? They want to take over Al-Aqsa. They want to bring the extremists to pray here, and this is what aggravates him, to pray. The Jews will pray on the Temple Mount. Because they want to force a fait accompli, a new fait accompli on the ground. And we always say that Al-Aqsa belongs to the Muslims only to the Muslims. And Jews have no right to Al-Aqsa at all. Means the Temple Mount. Jews have no right to the Temple Mount. Excuse me? The Mufti, only 80 years ago, wrote that this place is the place of Solomon's Temple, as we read, and even his father offered there whatever they offered. So how can this Mufti come and say the Jews have absolutely no right to the Temple Mount? This is actually a contradiction. Where did it come from? And the answer is very clear. Since the days of the first Mufti, until the days of this one, who denies everything, every connection between the Jews and the Temple Mount, some road accidents happened. The first one was 1948, when Jews succeeded to establish a state on part of the land of Israel. Second problem came in 1967, when Jews occupied another part of the country and Jerusalem as well. And now, what will happen again? That Jews want to come to the Temple Mount to pray, and all these things, the Jewish sovereignty, the Jewish state, and Jewish activity on Temple Mount, for them it means that Judaism actually comes back to life after Islam came to the world to replace Judaism. And for them, it is a religious threat on the mere existence of Islam. Because if Judaism comes back to life in the shape of a state, with an army, with a police, with ministries, with force and activity on the Temple Mount, in Jerusalem in general, and in Temple Mount in particular, It means for them that Judaism comes back to life after Islam came to the world to replace it. And this immediately poses a danger on Islam, because the whole raison d'etre of Islam is to cancel Judaism. And that's why, from the religious point of view, Muslims cannot fathom the Jews, that the Jews are coming back not only to their land, to their sovereignty, to their statehood, and to be active again in the Temple Mount. Because this means that Judaism goes through a process of resurrection after Islam came to the world to cancel it altogether. And for them, this is before anything connected to territory or to human rights or to political issues. It's first of all a religious problem which they cannot take. And this is why the Palestinians are not alone in this. And they know that if they will take a state without Jerusalem and leave Jerusalem for the Jews, the whole Islamic world will accuse them for betraying the Islam by leaving Jerusalem to the Jews to come back to life. And this is why they keep saying again and again that without Jerusalem, they will not establish a state, because they will not be willing to show their faces in front of their brethren, the Arabs and the Muslims, without Jerusalem, which remains in the Jewish hands. They cannot show their faces. They were so ashamed to show their faces within their brethren without Jerusalem. And this is why they keep claiming, again and again, I believe them, that they will not establish a state without East Jerusalem as their capital, because of this. Not only this, the Palestinians actually show it in this scarf which they produce. And this is the PLO, not Hamas, this is the flag of the PLO. On one side they say, Al-Quds Lana, Jerusalem is ours. But on the other side, they show Palestine, the complete country, the whole country. So where is Israel? They know the connection. Without Jerusalem, there will be no Israel. Without Zion, there is no Zionism, no Zionut. This is why they keep insisting on having Jerusalem, because they know that the world so far has not yet recognized Jerusalem as our capital. And this is a weak link in the chain of Judaism in the land of Israel. This is why they insist on Jerusalem. And whenever Israel does something which is viewed as perpetuation of our presence in Jerusalem, they get outraged, because for them it is a religious problem before anything else. In June 1st, 2008, one day before Yom Yerushalayim, the Israeli government decides to build some 800 or 900 apartments in Har Choma and Pisgat Ze'ev, two neighborhoods on places which were annexed to Jerusalem after the Six-Day War, after Jerusalem was liberated. And of course, they are outraged, and the jihad channel Al Jazeera dedicated that day in its main news bulletin no less than 15 minutes to this issue. Ladies and gentlemen, 15 minutes for one item in the main news bulletin, it's a big time. And the first they bring a footage from Jerusalem made by the correspondent in Jerusalem, a lady, which implicitly claims that Israel actually destroys all the Arab neighborhoods of Jerusalem out from the walls in order to build Jewish neighborhoods over their ruins. Sheer lie. The second one interviewed in this item was a Palestinian guy named Khalil Tafakji, who is in charge of maps in the Palestinian Authority, and he claims that Israel borders Jerusalem almost all over the West Bank. Again, sheer lie. And they looked for an Israeli to get on him because of all these things. They approached the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They didn't want to get into this question, so they went to the private market, and some speakers in Israel were busy that evening. I was free, so they approached me to come to the studio in order to give to an interview, as they call it, about what Israel decides to do in Jerusalem. Let me show you the interview. The broadcaster, his name is Jamal Rayan. He is the mastermind of Al Jazeera. He is the editor. He determines the wording, and the wording is very important when you want to label all kinds of people. He is the one who is in charge, and he is actually the first face which people saw on Al Jazeera when Al Jazeera was born in November 1996. He is in Qatar, the state which broadcasts Al Jazeera, and I am in Tel Aviv.
سيد مردخاي, هذا القرار هل هو دق مزيد من الأسفين في نعش المفاوضات الفلسطينية الإسرائيلية؟
أنا حقيقة لا أفهم هذا الكلام. هل على إسرائيل أن تبحث عن إذن من أين في العالم؟ هذه عاصمتنا منذ 3000 عام, وكنا هناك عندما كان آباؤكم يشربون الخمر ويأيدون البنات ويعبدون العزة واللات والمنات.
Again, pure history. We were in Jerusalem 3,000 years ago. Islam is only 14 centuries. Means we were in Jerusalem 16 centuries when their forefathers were still pagan Arabs in the Arab Peninsula, drinking wine, burying the daughters alive according to their sources, and worshipping idols and idolatries. Okay, so this is. I didn't invent anything. I just quoted their history. By the way, we do the same thing. In Haggadah of Pesach, we say clearly, "Mitchila of day avodah zara hayu avotenu." At the beginning, our forefathers were worshiping idols. Ve'ata kevanu makom l'avodato. And now, the Kadosh Baruch Hu got us closer to His worship. Okay? So, the same thing. They said the same thing about themselves.
فلماذا علينا أن نتكلم عن هذا الشيء؟ هذه هي مدينتنا من 3000 عام وإلى أبد الأبدين.
يا أخي, إذا كنت تريد عفواً سيد مردخاي, عفواً إذا كنت تريد أن تتحدث عن التاريخ, أيضاً نحن نتحدث عن القرآن. لا يمكن لك أن تلغي القدس من القرآن. أرجوك أن تبتعد عن الألفاظ التي تسيء للعرب والمسلمين. رجاءً لنبقى في موضوعنا لو سمحت. الآن هذا القرار ألا يتعارض,
لم يرد ذكر القدس في القرآن.
Here he quotes that verse which talks about Al-Aqsa, but he stopped quoting it because it doesn't mention Jerusalem. And Al-Aqsa originally, as you know already, was not in Jerusalem. It was in Jordan. It was brought to Jerusalem as fake news of the 7th century.
سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده.
ذكر القدس لم يرد في القرآن ولو مرة واحدة.
يا سيدي, لنتحدث بالسياسة. عفواً, لنتحدث بالسياسة.
الجزيرة.
لنتحدث بالسياسة لو سمحت.
أوكي. القدس خارج المفاوضات. القدس لليهود نكتة. لا يمكن الكلام عن القدس بأي شكل من الأشكال. وأنتم تعيدون هذه الكدية مرة تلو الأخرى
على المستوطنات. يا سيد مردخاي, المستوطنات.
In their terminology, every neighborhood in Jerusalem out from the walls is a settlement. Settlement of Beit Vagan, settlement of Beit HaKerem, settlement of Kiryat Moshe, settlement of Nachlaot, all these are settlements. Not to mention those who were established after the Six Day War, Givat Zarfatit, French Hill and Al-Khoma, all these are all settlements. This, by the way, the kind of wording in Jazeera, just to undermine the legitimacy of the Israeli presence in that place. But if you call it settlements, it's less than neighborhoods. Okay, the innuendo is bad. So this is why he says Mustawtanat means settlements.
نحن نتكلم عن شكك. يا أخي, نحن نتكلم عن شكك جديدة داخل مدينة القدس.
أنت تتحدث, عفوا سيد مردخاي, تتحدث عن بناء حوالي 1000 وحدة, وكان هناك قرار بإقامة 10,000 وحدة, وتم وقف هذا القرار, والآن تتم عملية تسريبات من تحت الطاولة 1000 2003. يعني القدس ربما ستشمل الضفة الغربية بعد ذلك, أليس كذلك؟
يا أخي, إسرائيل لا تعد الشكك التي تقيمها قطر في شبه جزيرة قطر, فما شأن لكم بالقدس؟
And here I must say something very serious. Al Jazeera, which broadcasts from Qatar, never talks about Qatar. Never. Everything which Al Jazeera brings is from other countries, from Israel, from the States, from Europe, from Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iraq, wherever. They never deal with Qatari issues. Only since Saudi Arabia put a siege on Qatar like 2 years ago, only then they talk about Saudi Arabia in this regard. But they never report anything about the Qatari government, about the Qatari, what they do, nothing. And most of the people in the Arab world do not even know that Al Jazeera broadcasts from Qatar, to that degree. The only thing which they do is sticking their nose in the pots of others to see what they cook. This.
القدس مدينتنا الى ابد الابدين ولا شان للدل الجزيره ولا لاف ولا لاحد في مدينه القدس نقطه هي مدينه لليهود فقط ليس لاحد اي شان بمدينه القدس
يعني هل تريد ان تقول بان كلامك هذا يعني بان المفاوضات التي تتم بين الفلسطينيين والاسرائيليين تتم بناء على الامر الواقع الذي تتحدث به الان يا سيد مردخاي كيدار
يا اخي انا ادعوك للقدس لتشوف بام عينك كيف القدس اصبحت مدينه زاهره بعد ان كانت خاربه تحت ايدي العرب حتى 67 نحن بنينا هذه المدينه من جديد وهي الان مفتوحه للمسيحيين وللمسلمين ولليهود على حد سواء كما لم تكن ابدا تحت سيطره الاسلام لان الاسلام اقصى اليهود من القدس والمسيحيين ايضا
طيب في بعض الاوقات انا اريدك ان تعطيني جوابا تعطيني جوابا يعني لماذا كلما كانت هناك مفاوضات فلسطينيه اسرائيليه تتحدثون عن الاستيطان وتصدرون قرارات بالاستيطان مزيد من قضم الأرض مزيد من تهويد الأراضي الفلسطينية وبالتالي قتل مقومات قيام أي دولة فلسطينية في المستقبل أليس كذلك؟
هناك حتى اليوم ولا حرج هناك دولتان فلسطينيتان دولة في غزة ودولة إن شاء الله ستقوم على الضفة الغربية وإذا استمر الفلسطينيون في هذا السلوك وعدم الجدية في المفاوضات ستكون هناك دولة في الخليل ودولة في رملة ودولة في نابلس ودولة
حسب المواصفات التي تتحدثون حسب المواصفات التي تضعتها إسرائيل ولكن القرارات الدولية مخالفة لكل ما تقول به يا سيد مردخاي القدس الشرقية محتلة الكل يعرف بذلك
الدفة الغربية ليس تابعة لأي دولة في العالم لأن ليس في هذه المنطقة أي سيادة لأي دولة مثل أنتاركتيكا في الجنوب لا 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 ليس الأردن كانت محتلة لهذه الأرض ليس في الدفة الغربية أي سيادة لأي دولة بخلاف الجولان بخلاف جزيرة سيناء بخلاف أجزاء أخرى الدفة الغربية ليس عليها أي سيادة لأي دولة في العالم ولذلك لا يمكن لأحد أن يكون بأني هذه هي منطقة محتلة من أي دولة احتلت هذه المنطقة الأردن كانت محتلة حتى 67 واليوم إسرائيل أيضا هي تحت سيطرة إسرائيل هذه المنطقة لا تتبع لأي دولة في العالم ولذلك نحن نتمكن من أن نقيم عليها ما نشاء
مردخاي كيدار قسم الدراسات العربية جامعة بار إيلان تل أبيب
He didn't thank me as he should and not only this after the program was finished at midnight he called Walid Al-Umari the one in charge of Al Jazeera in Israel and gave him a shower why he sent me so, and Walid told me this after some days so he said look Minister of Foreign Affairs didn't want to come others were busy and the only one who was available was Kedar and he wanted an Israeli and here you are deal with him because these are the Israelis of today they know what they want and they don't give up so since then and this was June 1st 2008, almost 11 years ago. I was invited to Al Jazeera several times, but not to programs of this man. He, doesn't want me, apparently. And actually, one time I was invited to the main news bulletin, and I told the one who invited me, if Jamal Rayan is the broadcaster, you better find out before you invite me, otherwise you're going to suffer. So he didn't allow you. Okay, so I knew that he doesn't want me. Towards the end of 2015, 7.5 years later, the man, Jamal Rayan, sits and explains his policy in editing Al Jazeera, as the mastermind of Al Jazeera. And he relates to the question of inviting Israelis, because there are many Arab newscasts or radios and TVs who boycott Israel and do not invite Israeli altogether. And Al Jazeera does. So he wanted to explain about what happens with Israelis and why he invites them. And he says,
قد يعتب البعض انه لماذا تستضيف اسرائيليين انا بالعكس انا من الناس اللي بشجع هذا انا بعتبر انه لما بيكون عندي ضيف اسرائيلي في اي فتره اخباريه انا بعتبره صيدي
Now you know it's not an assumption and it's not some kind of maybe he says it the man who is in charge of Al Jazeera says in a way which cannot be clearer And you know what you understand it, what he says. Listen to what he says.
لأنه إذا هو بدي يقدم روايته أنا قادر على ضحض هذه الرواية. الجزيرة تعتمد على الرأي والرأي الآخر. وعدم وجود طرف ثاني تصبح يعني صوت واحد وغير مقنع. ناول القضية الفلسطينية بحس أني منبر للدفاع عن القضية الفلسطينية. طبعا في بعض الأحيان لا تخلو مواقف صعبة بالنسبة لي حينما أقابل إسرائيليين. لأعطيك مثال كان معي بروفيسور من جامعة بار إيلان اسمه مردخاي كيدار وكانت المقابلة مضمون المقابلة وهدف المقابلة هو الحديث عن أسباب استمرار الاستيطان في الضفة الغربية والتوسع الاستيطاني في القدس وغير ذلك فطرحت عليه هذا السؤال شو الهدف؟ فقال لي القدس لليهود نقطة هذه عاصمتنا من أبد الآبدين أنتوا العرب والمسلمين لما كنتوا في القدس كنتوا تشربون الخمر وتؤيدون البنات
يشربون الخمر ويؤيدون البنات ويعبدون العزة واللات والمنات
They inserted this part of that interview into his monologue in the editing they took it from the archive and they put it into his monologue.
هذه هي مدينتنا من 3000 عام والى
فقلت له اذا كنت تريد ان تتحدث عن التاريخ لا يمكن لك ان تلغي القدس من القران.
دكتور فهمان here it was that he's learned because فهمان in Arabic is not only learned. This man he knows. That's what we say like this. He knows. فهمان that's what he said. هذا دكتور فهمان You know.
طبعا ودكتور فهمان قال لي القدس لم ترد في القرآن فعلا القدس لم ترد في القرآن ولكن الله أسعفني في تلك اللحظة وقلت له سبحان
الذي أسرى بعبده
ذكر القدس لم يرد في القرآن مرة واحدة
Ladies and gentlemen I spoke yesterday in I don't remember where not far from here Shari Tfilah and I sort of remember more or less what I said. I don't remember everything which I said. And this was yesterday. The man, after 7.5 years, memorizes my name, knows my name, although he interviewed me only one time, knows my university, and quotes line after line from that interview. And the man actually interviews every single day dozens of people. Because he's the main narrator of Al Jazeera. What happened? Why? Why? And this man is the most powerful man in the whole Arab world. Because he holds to the heaviest stick named Al Jazeera, by which he can hit whoever he wants. If he wants to kill somebody politically, in no time he does it with Al Jazeera. Disseminates news and fake news. Nobody knows what is true or not. He can kill people. And this is why he is one of the most powerful people in the Arab world. And he remembers line after line from an interview which he did with Israeli professor 7.5 years earlier. Why? Why? And the answer is very clear. This was the first time which he has to face the reality, which actually negates his belief about Judaism. Because for him, an Israeli who is knowledgeable about Islam, who fights for his state, is actually the resemblance. He resembled the resurrection of Judaism. And he is an Israeli, he lives in Israel. And he's a state. Means that the whole thing for him was a trauma. And if you look at him, all his tics, when he's speaking about me, you can see how the whole thing is post-traumatic phenomenon, which you see. This is why he remembers everything. This is why apparently he walks around with a puppet in my shape and he stabs it like voodoo. But the issue is not me. The issue is actually they. He belongs to the Muslim Brotherhood. And for them, the Muslim Brotherhood, Jerusalem, is something totally different from what we understand. This is the center of their discourse. I'll show you. May 1, 2012, Cairo, the launching of the election campaign of Morsi. Morsi was for 1 year was a president of Egypt between mid-2012 and 2013. How he was ousted by Sisi, the president of today. The campaign took 2 months, started in May 1 until the end of June. And that day, on the stage in an Egyptian street in Cairo, happens what I want to show you, courtesy of Mary.
رأينا حلم الخلافة الإسلامية حلم أرض الخلافة يتحقق بإذن الله على يد الدكتور محمد مرسي ومن معه من إخوانه وجماعته وحزبه رأينا الحلم الكبير الذي نحلم به جميعا الولايات المتحدة العربية الولايات المتحدة العربية ستعود إن شاء الله ستعود الولايات المتحدة العربية على يد هذا الرجل ومن معه إن شاء الله ستكون عاصمة الخلافة ستكون عاصمة الولايات المتحدة العربية هي القدس إن شاء الله.
Not only the capital of the Palestinian state, the capital of the Arab world united under the Muslim Brotherhood. Okay? And he repeats it after the crowd shouts.
Takbir! Takbir! Takbir!
ستكون عاصمتنا. ليست القاهرة ولا مكة ولا المدينة وإنما القدس إن شاء الله وسيكون هتافنا على القدس رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس رايحين
شهداء بالملايين
على القدس رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس
رايحين شهداء بالملايين على القدس
رايحين شهداء بالملايين
على القدس means to Jerusalem, are marching millions of Shaheeds. Okay? This is, and he's not a Palestinian even. He doesn't speak from the Palestinian point of view. He speaks from the Islamic point of view, because this is the problem of the Islam, the fact that we Jews are in Jerusalem, in our capital, goes for them. When we control Jerusalem, they cannot fathom this, because it's a threat on Islam, because they are afraid that if Judaism comes back to life, again will come the clowns of the city and say that Islam is no more than asatir al-awwalin, copy and paste from Jewish sources, and they cannot accept it. This is why the struggle of Jerusalem is actually the struggle of Islam on its validity. Because if Judaism comes back to life in Jerusalem, it means that Islam has no role in the world. After all, Islam to the world to replace Judaism and Christianity. And here, the conspiracy. Israel was established by whom? By the British Empire under the leadership of Balfour, who was an evangelical Christian. Means this is conspiracy between the Christians and the Jews. Later, the League of Nations, who accepted the declaration and made it into an international document in Sanremo, 1920. Again, now the world, who the heck gave the Japanese the permission to give an Islamic soil like Eretz Israel, Palestine, to the Jews, who do not deserve to have any state, who should live under the Islamic yoke as dhimmis? Who the heck gave the Russians and the other members of the League of Nations the permission to vote to give the Jews an Islamic land which belongs to us? And this is why they don't accept any international document, including the Sanremo Convention, not to mention the others. So this is the conspiracy between the Jews and the Christian world. And now come Trump with the evangelical here supporting, and he recognizes Jerusalem as the capital of the Jews. Who the heck gave him Jerusalem to give it to the Jews? Well, it belongs to his father. He inherited from his father. What? So everything which happens in the world today, which actually is some kind of recognition of the fact that Jerusalem belongs to the Jews, they totally are against it. Because nobody in the world has the permission to give our city, which, look, according to Islam, any country, any land, any city has only one way ticket to enter Islam, not to get out from Islam. And since Jerusalem was once occupied by the Muslims, so it should remain forever. Nobody has the permission to take any land, any city, any piece of land from the Islamic world. So this is totally against the Sharia. The same thing, by the way, with Spain and with Sicily and with other parts of the Balkans, all the way to the gates of Vienna, when they were defeated, where they were defeated in 1683. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the struggle. The struggle is not a territorial struggle. The struggle is a religious struggle of Islam to prove its validity on the expense of Judaism and Christianity, by the way. Now the question is, what do we do with this? Do we surrender? Do we give up on our place, our capital, our holy city? Or do we tell them, guys, your holy city is in Mecca. Jerusalem is holy to us, maybe Christians as well. You go there, this is your place. You occupied Jerusalem in 638 when you didn't even consider Jerusalem to be holy at that time. The whole thing about the holiness of Jerusalem was concocted by the Umayyads because of the rebellion in Mecca when they couldn't go to Hajj. And the proof is that the enemies of the Umayyads, the Shia, did not accept the idea that Jerusalem is a holy city. And this is why Shia have another city, Najaf, and they don't consider. Why? Because their enemies, the Umayyads, those who beheaded Hussein bin Ali, their caliph, or their almost caliph. This is why the Shia is against it. And this clip, which I showed you with me and Jamal Ayan, had thousands of talkbacks, and I recognized those from Iraq according to their dialect and according to the names of the people, which the typical Iraqi names, they support the Jewish hold to Jerusalem. Because for them, they have another holy city, Najaf, and they actually are against the Sunnah. So this is the struggle of Jerusalem, which involves also forging maps. Jordan When Jordan was in Jerusalem until 67, the Jordanian government published books and maps about Jerusalem. Look at this. I have it here, I can show you the original. Guide to the West Bank of Jordan, Jerusalem. This book was published in 1963, 4 years before we liberated Jerusalem from the Jordanian occupation. This map is attached, is glued to the first page. Let me show you the map. What does it say here? Mount Moriah. The Al-Aqsa is the building in the south of the court. Solomon's stables. Valley of Jehoshaphat. Tomb of Zakaria. Absalom's pillar. Mount Zion. Half of the Bible is in a Jordanian map, and the Jordanians were not Zionists in those days. They are not Zionists until today. But the Jordanian Ministry of Tourism had no problem to publicize this map of Jerusalem with all the Jewish names of places and areas in the in Jerusalem. Another map which mentions this is this. This is a property of a friend of mine, Chaim Steinberger, who lives in New York. And look at this. Mount Moriah. This is not empty, this is a real mount, okay? And the gates. And Al-Aqsa again is the building in the southern part of the court. And I've many more Jordanian maps which state the same thing. Mount Moriah and Al-Aqsa in the south. After 67, after we liberated Jerusalem, the maps are redrawn. Let me show you one or two of them. Here, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is the whole thing. The building in the south changes its name. And now it's called Al-Masjid Al-Qibli. Masjid Al-Qibli in Arabic means the mosque of the direction of the prayer. Because it's in the south, and they pray to the south to Mecca. So, since Al-Aqsa became the whole space, the whole court, now the mosque in the south, which formerly was Al-Aqsa, in the Jordanian maps, now it is called the mosque of the direction of the prayer. Why did they change the naming of Al-Aqsa and the mosque in the south? The reason is very clear. Since 1967, Rabbi Goren, who was then the chief military rabbi of Tzahal, of the IDF, and his brother-in-law, Rav Shar Yashuv Kohen, the rabbi of Haifa, called upon the Israeli government to establish a synagogue, to build a synagogue in the northern end of the Temple Mount. Because this part was not annexed to the Temple Mount by Hordos and the Rabbanim allows it, actually. So they want to pray on the Temple Mount in a place which was for sure not part of Beit HaMikdash in the old times. For the Muslims, if Jews start to pray on Temple Mount, this is what they are afraid of. That Judaism comes back to life on the Temple Mount. So, in order to incite all the Muslims in the world, they call the whole thing Al-Aqsa, because Al-Aqsa appears in the Quran. And now, the Jews are actually challenging the Al-Aqsa. Not Al-Aqsa in the Quran, Al-Aqsa, the whole thing. Now, since the whole thing is called Al-Aqsa, since 1967, they have to give a new name to the mosque in the south. So now it became the southern mosque or the south or the mosque of the direction of the prayer. And this change happened after 1967. This shows you that fake news were not invented in the United States of America in the 21st century. It was in the Islamic world already in the 7th century and in the 20th century. So nobody can has royalties on fake news. They can show other people how to do it very well. After all, the hadith, large parts of it were concocted and many things as we saw. Ladies and gentlemen, the question now is left for us, Jews in Israel and abroad. Do we succumb to such discourse which denies us from all the rights which we had in Eretz Israel, in Jerusalem, denies our history, denies our religion, and claims that our religion is din batel, means religion of null and void? Or do we fight? My personal approach, we cannot otherwise but fight. Fight back. It's not easy. It's a challenge, yet it is doable. Because now we can use social media and other things which we can. However, don't forget that we are a small nation. If every one of us will send only 10 emails a day about Jerusalem, or 10 posts on Facebook about Jerusalem in favor of Judaism, and everyone in the Islamic world will do it, they outnumber us big time, because there are billion and a half Muslims in the world, and one of 15 million maybe Jews in the world. So they will defeat us in no time. We have to get to work on this thing. Every one of us who has access to email, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever, in my humble view, should get under the stretcher and start working. Because otherwise, since they outnumber us, and they have much more money than us, and they have much more presence in the United Nations, and they influence some kinds of organizations like UNESCO, they might defeat us if we sit, lay back, and wait for Israel to do the job. It's the job of every Jew and everyone who supports the Judaism and the Jewish presence in Eretz Israel in general and in Jerusalem in particular. Ladies and gentlemen, get to work. Thank you so much.